So today I wanted to talk to you today because we're in March, and this has happened to be what I had got in my spirit. And I taught some things about spiritual warfare and some things about the battle between good and evil several times here at the church, but I hadn't preached in it probably a long while. So God began to reveal to me that it's another season, new people. I needed to go ahead and teach it today, and I believe that God is doing something like never before. Anybody here understand that as much as we think we have it down, sin is always there? I got to unpack this for a moment and give you an understanding that you can be as goody two shoes as you want to be, but as soon as somebody touch you the right way or speak to you the wrong way, all of a sudden sin creeps out. Y'all done got quiet on me. I appreciate that. That means y'all hearing me. What I'm saying to you is there is always a battle, a struggle going on between the spirit of things and the flesh of things. For instance, there are people in our circle that when they love us, they love us. But when they treat us bad, you know it. Everybody in your neighborhood know it. Everybody's what's going on because they punched you or touched you the wrong way. When I mean punched you, I don't mean they hit you. They just hit you with the right saying that caused you to get off the love line. So go with me to the book of Romans, the book of Romans 7. I won't be before you long. I have 4 points, and we're gonna break down this word, but I'm also going to break down a hymn that was sung a way long time ago. Look to your neighbor and say, "Onward, Christian soldier." That's an old hymn. Yeah, see, I know some people that actually went to church when we were smaller, we know that song. Some of us won't. We might not even be able to find it. So Romans 7, you got to say amen. Romans 7 verse 14 says, "For we know the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that I do I not. But what I hate, that do I." Seems like Paul, the writer, begins to get into a spiritual battle within himself, getting to understand that every time I'm trying to do good, the evil tries to creep on him. And when I try to go and do evil, good starts to talk to him. Sometimes you have to understand, when you're going the wrong way, the Spirit of God tries to put you on the right way, because there's a battle that goes on in the mind and in the spirit over what you're going to do. I feel like there's an anointing in this house to break the demonic off of our lives. How many people know that there's still oppression that's trying to keep us down? Look to your neighbor and say, "Trying to keep me down." Lack is trying to keep me down. Pride trying to keep me down. Guilt trying to keep me down. Anger trying to keep me down. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Sickness and disease trying to keep me down. There's a spirit that has tried to keep me down for way too long. But I ain't putting it up with it no more. You talk to yourself, say, "I'm not putting up with it no more." When we open up the Bible is full of understanding of how we as Christian warriors, as we as soldiers, have to battle. Amen? So let's keep reading. It says, "Now then, it's no more that I do it, but sin that dwelleth in me." How many people know that grace is powerful? Look to the next and say, "Grace." Grace will put you in a place, even when you fall in sin, grace will restore you. When you fall in sin, mercy will heal you. When you fall in sin, God had already preordained, preset you up that you would still be called his son of God or daughter of God. I'm not talking about the grace is not a license for you to go out and sin and do whatever you want to do. Grace is just the backstop that keep you from falling. Amen. I know I'm just laying a foundation. Believe me, I'm getting ready to preach, and it's going to be hard, and y'all not going to know what hit you. "For I know that in me, that is my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, But how to perform that which is good, I find not. He said, because of this flesh, sin is always there. How many people know that we were born into sin? The Bible tells David that I was born into sin, but your grace and mercies. We have to understand that, yes, we're bound to make mistakes. Nobody's perfect. Look to your neighbor and say, nobody's perfect. Nobody is perfect. Look to you, tell yourself that. Sometimes we got a spirit of perfection that hurt us the most. It stopped us from who we're being because we got I'm going to talk about Adam when he was smaller. He's different now. But when he was smaller, he would draw a piece of art and he would get all the way to the end. And if it didn't look right, he would crumple it all up, throw it away, start fresh. He would get it until you'd have a basket full of trash of artwork that was just off by a little bit. He had a spirit of perfection that was just it would just drive us. I would say we go in this room the next day, there'd be a whole basket full of papers again. All right. Don't you know that only person that's perfect is Jesus? The only person that's perfect is the Lord. The Holy Spirit will perfect the things that concern you, but it doesn't make you perfect right now. So what you have to deal with, the perfection, you have to deal with the pain of not being perfect. You need to forgive yourself for not being perfect. You need to forgive yourself for not expecting other people to be perfect. Our problem is we expect people who can't be perfect to be perfect. We expect ourselves who can't be perfect to be perfect. So right now I repent on behalf of ourselves that we cannot be perfect. So I cannot be perfect. Amen. For the good that I would do, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it's no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. How many people know that evil is always creeping around good? Evil is always there. When you're jumping up trying to do right, evil always is trying to do wrong. When you're ready to fight the battle, the good fight, you're ready to war against the enemy, don't you know that evil always trying to hold you down? Evil is always there to try and stop your plan of God to happen in your life. And verse 23 says, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind. Look to your neighbor and say, war. I'd like to tell you today that the message is about how a Christian soldier is supposed to war. The message today is about how a Christian soldier is supposed to be on the offense and not on the defense. I come to tell you today that a Christian soldier is ready to attack the enemy and not the enemy and waiting for the enemy to attack. I come to tell you that in Romans 7 and 23 says, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind. How many people know that the flesh will tell you one thing, your mind will tell you another? How many people will tell you that the flesh will always tell you to do wrong, even though your mind is telling you to do right? Anybody understand what I'm saying? There's a war that goes on in the spirit that your flesh begin to battle against your own mind. Your mind is telling you didn't need that extra piece of pie. That mind is telling you didn't need that smoke. The mind is telling you didn't need to go over, make that call at 2 o'clock in the morning. But the flesh is, oh, y'all not talking to me. The flesh is warring against that mind. Look to them and say, but onward, Christian soldier. And saying, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Paul, powerful man of God, preaching and teaching a text about the battle that's going on in his mind. This is the man of God that wrote about 30% of the Bible. This is the man of God that wrote letters and established multiple churches in ministry. This is the man of God that was first a persecutor of the Christians, but now the chief apostle of the Christians other than Jesus. This is a man of God that's telling you, even up into this day, I done established a church of Rome. I done established a church of Corinth. I done established a church of Ephesus. I done established a church of Philadelphia. I done established a church of Philemon. I done established these churches. I done established these churches of Thessalonica. I done traveled these churches. I done wrote these letters. I done did ministry. But now I find myself still warring against my own flesh. What keeps you away? What keeps you anyway different than Paul? Paul was a learned man. Paul saw God. Paul had an experience with God. But yet he still warred against his flesh. He still had challenges in his body. He still didn't understand how God could move in him and the sin could still be present. We think we done attained as onward Christian soldiers. We don't think we did as warriors for God. But come to tell you, brothers and sisters, that you'll find out that even as you go up, sin is trying to go up with you. You think it was a happenstance that Eddie Long got in trouble? No. He went up, sin went up. Look to your neighbor and say, onward Christian soldier. Can I preach the lyrics for you just a moment? Can I preach the lyrics for you? I don't do this, but the hymn writer, when they hit it, it just made so much sense. So I want to give it to you as it was written. It says, onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ, the royal master, leads against the foe, forward into battle, see his banner go. If you're not warring with Christ on your sleeve, you're not warring at all. The shield of Jesus need to go before you. Matter of fact, my shield of Jesus is what they call a bubble. It go before me. It covers my back, my side, my head, and my feet. I live in a bubble of Jesus. Look to them. I live in a bubble of Jesus. This girl here. At the sign of triumph, Satan's host does flee. On then, Christian soldiers, on to victory. Look to your neighbor and say, I'm victorious. Say, I'm victorious. I'm victorious. I'm going to unpack this in a minute with 4 points, but I want you to get these lyrics in your heart. Hell's foundations quiver at the shout of praise. I want you to highlight that for a moment. I don't write this down. This is not a point, but this is a sub point. Hell's foundations quiver at the shout of praise. The reason why you don't beat down the devil as much as you can is because you don't praise enough. The reason why you don't have the devil defeated in your life is because when the preacher, the singer get up and tell you to praise God, your mouth is quiet. The reason why you're not marching to the same beat as everybody else is because you don't talk enough to God. Somebody need to talk to God. Somebody need to shout hallelujah. Somebody need to say, I praise you, Jesus. I need victory. When they singing out there, they singing a praise song, and you standing, you sitting on your hands, you got your suit or your dress all done and you don't want to mess up your hair, and you're missing out on your breakthrough, baby. Y'all need to understand that there's power in your praise. There's healing in your praise. There's deliverance in your praise. There's salvation in your praise. There's financial peace in your praise. There's breakthrough. Anybody need a breakthrough? Anybody need a breakthrough? Start praising the Lord. Why don't y'all just praise the Lord for a minute? I was reaching for my drink, but I realized who I am. Let's keep reading. Brothers, lift your voices, loud your anthems raise. Like a mighty army, this is the third verse. Like a mighty army moves the church of God. Brothers, we are treading where the saints have trod. Sometimes we need to go where the people of God have went before you. Right? Paul told you. Thank you, brother. Paul will tell you, I wish that you wouldn't have to go through what I went through. But I did blaze the trail for you. He said, I pressed that you go to the mark. Say, press to the mark of the high calling. He says these things so that you could get an understanding of where he is going and where you should be going. Amen? He said, we are not divided. Look to your next, we're not divided. I'm going to help you out. Division is a tool of the enemy. I want you to get this. When your marriage doesn't succeed, there's division at home. When your finances aren't succeeded, there's division in your mind. Division is a tool of the enemy. That's why the songwriter said, onward Christian soldiers, we are not divided. Look today and say, we are not divided. We are not divided. I got a couple more verses and then I'll actually preach. Is that okay? Y'all probably said, but this dude here been preaching for the last half an hour and he ain't said nothing yet. We are not divided, all one body, we. One in hope and doctrine, one in charity. Love. We just came out of love month. One in hope, one in the word, one in charity. Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng. Blend with your your voices in the triumph song. Glory, Lord, and honor unto Christ the King. This throw countless ages, men and angels sing. I want you to understand that when you get in that number, you're not in that number by yourself, baby. When you get in that number, there's power when you get on the team. The reason why we're not a soldier, but we are soldiers together, is because there's power in numbers. That's why there's platoons that go to war. You don't have individuals going to war. You got platoons. You got companies. You got whole divisions going to war. What I'm saying to you, we stronger way more together. One can make fleet fly to 1,000, to 10,000. How many of you think? How many think 100 can do or 50 can do? Woo, we can beat back a whole bunch of devils, baby. What I'm saying to you is we and angels together. I had somebody comment on the post that I said, the word that was so powerful. He tried to say, well, angels only respond to to us men that are saved. That's what he said on the Facebook response. Yeah. And when I read the word, this way he said they respond to the spoken word of the people here on earth that are believers. In theory, that would be correct. In action, that's incorrect. I'm going to help you out. When you say negative words, you got your angels unemployed. When you preach the unadulterated word of God, or you speak word into your life, angels begin to do action. However, the book of Exodus is laid out in 23, to understand that in that particular, that's why it wasn't the little angels. It was capitalized, the word angel, in there. In Exodus 23, this is what he didn't get, and I want to correct that so that he'd understand. Angel in Exodus 23 really speaks specifically to your access to God. Because God said that I will send an angel to you. And he says, obey that angel. That's what it says in Exodus 23. It says, obey that angel. Listen to what he's saying. If that was the little angel, your words would send that angel to work. But since it was the big angel, I'm talking to somebody that's a warrior right now. I'm talking to somebody that's getting ready to go to battle for. When you get a big angel, that angel truly represents your connection to God. And God is speaking specifically through that angel because he's speaking my words is what the Bible says. In Exodus, listen to that angel because he's talking on behalf of me. What he's saying is you're big, you're strong. As you do these feasts, I got your back. I'm going to send you not a little angel that will do your bidding, but I got to send you a big angel that's going to do my bidding. When you're worrying for God, when you're doing what God called you to do, when you're walking in the anointing of God, don't you know God don't send you the little angel. He send you the 20, 30, 50, 100-foot angel that's getting ready to fight your battles like never before. He going to send you the archangels that know the voice of the Lord and speak the proverbs onto your devils. When they get to fight, they get to the battle, and they get to go up. Let's go to your neighbor and say, we going up. The reason why we needed to walk in love in February is so that we can rise up in March. When you walk in love, you're warring against so many devils you don't even know about. When you're walking in love, you're defeating so many enemies because love covers a multitude of foes, baby. But here we go. I'm going to give you 4 points and we're getting ready to go home. Look to your neighbor and say, onward, Christian soldier, march in the war. Say, march in the war. Y'all ain't know. Y'all was just getting happy. This dude stopped. Gotta talk to these people, boy. Second Timothy 2:1-4. I'm getting ready to preach. I'm just gonna lay this scripture down, and then I'm finna unpack it a little bit. You know, a teacher always come out of me. As much as I want to preach and just make you cry and jump and make you dance, I got to teach you something first. Then I'll get it in you. Amen. 2 Timothy 2:1-4 says, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Look to your neighbor saying, be strong. My first point is, a good soldier, say a good soldier. Good soldier knows he is strong enough to know when he is weak. A good soldier knows how to follow orders, but a good soldier knows he is strong enough of a man or strong enough as a woman to know that you're weak without God. Look to your neighbor and say, through Christ, I'm strong, but I know normally, without God, I'm weak. I don't understand what God has taken us, but we as Christian soldiers, look to your neighbor and say, I'm an onward Christian soldier, that I'm pushing forward, I'm raising up in March, that God begin to operate, that I know that God knows that my weaknesses, he's getting ready to turn into my strengths. My downfalls, he's getting ready to turn up and make me strong. Where I am weakest at, he's going to give me a helpmate, or he's going to give me something in my spirit that's going to make me strong again. What I'm saying is, if you know your weakness is spending money, God going to send somebody that's going to keep your money straight. If you know your weaknesses are spiritual, God going to send you somebody. So he's going to send you the Holy Spirit to make you strong. Look to your neighbor and say, make me strong. Anybody understand what I'm saying? Say, just tell yourself, say, I'm a Christian soldier. I'm ready to go to battle. A good soldier, say a good soldier, is strong enough to know when they are weak. Say, I'm a good soldier. Good soldier, this is not in my text, but a good soldier follows orders. I'm going to change my number. That is, God just downloaded that to me. That is a point two. I know I gave you another point in there, but say a good soldier follows orders. Where can you find those orders at? In the Word of God. Let's look at a couple. Let's look at a couple. Joshua 1. When you got it, say amen. This order came from God directly to Joshua. He said, be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance in the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be strong. Don't you know he gave you the order to be strong and courageous? He said, only be strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not from it the right hand or the left, that thou mayest prosper whatsoever thou goest. How many people know there's a battle, a financial battle in your mind that God said, if you just do what I tell you to do, that wherever you goest, you shall prosper. If you follow the law, wherever you should go, so Joshua 1, 6, and 7, that you shall prosper. What, and then he goes into 8 and then said, be thou very and whatever you doeth, I feel that y'all need to stand up for a second. Stand up. Stand up, everybody. Be good soldiers. Follow orders. Say, in Jesus' name, I'm in this dark time, in this battle, spiritual warfare, battle between the spirit and the flesh, I'm going to follow God's orders. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, Joshua 6. Now, Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given thine hand Jericho and the king thereof and mighty men of valor. You shall compass the city, all ye men of war. I got any warriors in the house? All you men of war. I got any warriors in the house? I want you to follow this text. I want you to hear this text because it begins to lay it out. As God gave Joshua the orders, Joshua gave the orders unto the people. There's an anointing in here to follow orders right now. And God's giving you some orders. And God's going to tell you something right now. And you need to go home and do this. That all you men of war, all you warriors, go round about the city once, that thou shalt do 6 days, and the seven priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of the ram horn, and the seventh day ye shall compass the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow with trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when you make a long blast with the ram's horn, when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the walls of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up every man straight before him. What God is saying spiritually is in this time and season, if there's something that's got you bound, if there's something that's been a wall against what you're doing, I want you to find it. If it may be your bills, it could be your bedroom, it could be your children. You need to walk around their room 6 times, and then on the 7th, do it 7 times more. That's what the Bible is saying. It's saying 6 plus 1 makes 7, and on that 7th time, begin to shout. Begin to make a holy noise. Begin to give up and give God some praise. Begin to give God a Holy Ghost happy and a joy. Begin to worship the Lord like never before, and you're gonna see the walls start tumbling down. If your bills is if this was representing your bills, you'd be that's one, baby. That's two. I'm gonna get dizzy. That's three. Four. 5, 6, 7. And I begin to shout, and I start to see my debt come tumbling down. I start to see my finances are getting better. I start to feel my bills being paid. I start to feel the anointing of financial freedom in my life. I begin to feel what God has me to feel. What I'm saying is, you need to do, because these are warriors. Any warriors in the house? Any Christian soldiers in the house? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Whew. Yep. Last night our camera wasn't working. Stuff wasn't working right. I'm telling you, I begin to pray. And in my spirit, I begin to walk around that camera well one time. I begin to keep walking two times. Then it got to seven times. And even in the middle of the night, I begin to shout and praise. I got a prophetess asked me, "What'd you get up so early for?" I said, "I'm just taking care of me. I got this. I'm working on my word, but working on what God's got going on." And I felt that I came in. I didn't come in early. I came at regular time. Why? Because I already knew God had dealt with that wall. Sometimes y'all need to understand. You might not see it right now, but God done dealt with that wall. You might, that sickness wall is coming down, baby. That debt wall is coming down, baby. That addiction wall is coming down, baby. Whatever is that wall that's keeping you bound is coming down. Look to your neighbors, it's coming down. It's coming down. That wall is coming down. So a warrior knows he's strong enough to know when he's weak. He knows to follow orders. Anybody know who to follow orders? Follow orders? Romans 13. I gotta give you more text. Y'all some smart people, so I gotta give you word. And this is, let every soul be subject unto the higher power, for there's no power but of God, the power that are ordained of God. Whosoever there resisted the power resisted the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive themselves damnation. This is not a talking about salvation. That's saying as much as you resist the word of God from the people of God that had been ordained by God, you are causing your own self trouble. Say, I'm not that type of warrior. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. Look to your neighbor and say, get it? I got it. Amen. Say, we good warriors follow orders. Verse 2 says, and back in 2 Timothy 2, 1, we're at 2 Timothy 2 and 2 says, and the things that which you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. This is the text. This is what the text say. This is not what I'm saying. For y'all to understand that the more you go up in rank in the spirit, the more hardship going to try and come against you. What I'm saying is God is getting ready to take you higher. But know that the higher you go, the hardship's also going to come. You're going to see as you begin to speak in tongues, as you begin to do wonders of God, as you begin to do signs and wonders, and you begin to cancel out devils in your life, there are going to be greater devils try to come against you. I know that sounds not good, but that means you're doing something right. You've been following orders. You done got up in rank. You went from a private to a corporal. You went from a corporal to a sergeant. You went from a sergeant to a lieutenant. You went from a lieutenant to a captain. You went from a captain to a major. You went from a major to a colonel. You went from a colonel to a general. And then you went to 1-star general, 2-star general, 3-star general, 4-star, till you're the commander of the Navy, baby, or the commander of the Army, or the commander of the Marines. And then from there, you're chief secretary of the Navy. And there you don't answer to one more person but the president. And who's the commander in chief? What I'm saying is, the higher you go, the more the enemy with hardship try to come on you. Look to the neighbor and say, I get it. I get it. You know, I still know my ranks, baby. Look to your neighbor and say, I get it. Verse 4, now I'm going to stop. I'm going to stop reading and start preaching. Is that okay? I got about another 10 minutes. Is that all right? I'm going to take it anyway. But no one engaged. Look at this. Verse 4 says, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. If you're in warfare, you cannot be entangled with the life, with the things of this world. Look, then they say a good warrior does not get entangled with the world. A good warrior does not get entangled with the world. Because if you get too twisted up with the world, when you call to war, you're not ready. Because you got to let Pookie them know. You got to kiss off all your girlfriends and tell them, hey, it's time for me to go ahead and go. You got to clean your blood from the alcohol and the drugs. When you get too entangled with the world, I can't read it. You have enemies. Good. It means you've stood up for something in your life. Winston Churchill, powerful. Look to your neighbor and say, that's powerful. So what the Bible is saying is, if you get trapped up in the world, when they call your number, baby, you ain't ready. Yeah, it's too late. If you're getting ready to get ready, it's too late. You need to be ready. Say, I'm ready. I'm a warrior ready. I'm on alert, baby. I've been drafted. I am ready to go. Now I'm gonna give you my point. Y'all may be sitting. I'm getting ready to preach now, okay? I done got the scriptures out. I'm getting ready to preach. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Now you good. You stand if you want. That's on you. My first point, he's strong enough to know when he's weak. Second point, good soldier follows orders. Third point, good soldier is humble in victory. I skipped one. He's brave enough to face himself when he's afraid. Oh, this one is deep. He's brave enough to face himself when he's afraid. I want you to sit on that for a moment as I begin to understand that when you're at your scariest moment, a good soldier reaches inside of himself to find the Spirit of God to take him to another level. When you're going through what you're going through, when you're battling warrior upon warrior, the spirit of debt and the spirit of lack, the spirit of anger in your marriage, the spirit of wrath, the spirit of confusion, all this stuff going on, God begin to speak to you and you begin to look inside yourself for a little bit more. You begin to look inside yourself for a greater measure of the Spirit. You begin to look inside yourself for an upgrade in your faith. You begin to look inside yourself for some peace from God. You begin to look inside yourself for the things, the very things you need to defeat not just one devil, but to defeat multiple devils that are attacking your life. What I'm saying is oppression may come on you, but you'll look inside yourself to be able to be brave enough to face the enemy, and even if the enemy is you, baby. Even if you're the one that's causing you the issue, even if you're the one that's stopping your breakthrough, even if you're the one that's stopping your miracle, God will give you the wisdom and understanding how to bring it out of you to fight against yourself. Look to your neighbor and say, I get it. I get it. Say, he's brave enough to face himself even when he's afraid. And fear is from the enemy. So even when the enemy sends you fear, you're brave enough to stand up. This is deep right here. Because the biggest challenge we have in the body of Christ is being brave in the midst of adversity. The easy thing for me to do is to do nothing and watch the enemy win. The hardest thing for me to do is to stand up and fight, even when fighting takes a toll from who I am. I need a couple of volunteers. I need Tim and Deacon Harris. I want them too. Those are my two volunteers today. You've been called out. Now, these are two big men. I'm not talking about them, but they're strong big men, right? Amen? Turn around. Now, when this is a soldier and this is the enemy, right? He might not be afraid to face this type of battle. Right? Flip it around. All right, this dude is 6'3", 400. He just told us, right? 6 what? 6'4". He's 6'4", 400, right? He's carrying loads upon loads. This is oppression. This is lack. This is anger. This is wrath. This is addiction. This is alcoholism. This is cigarette smoke. This is all the things that are trying to battle against him. When he sees this wall, or he sees this thing so big, it looks he could be trying to shrink down a little bit. But no, he's a warrior, baby. He's a man of God. He's ready to fight. And the battle, he said, I'm brave enough to understand, even when the battle's bigger than me, I'm going to win. I'm brave enough to understand. Y'all not talking to me. I'm brave enough to win. And look at me, baby. I look like a little thimble in between these two big giants. What I'm saying is, I'm brave enough to see all those things that are trying to come against me. All those things trying to come against me. I'm brave enough to understand that I'm not going to win anyway. It's going to be God that's going to win through me. So I got the victory, baby. So I'm going to be brave enough to understand that you can't beat me. You can't beat me. And I don't care. You got to have a little New York in you. You got to have a little Peter in you. You got to have somebody that, you know what? I ain't standing for that. I don't care who you are. You might be from Miami. You might be from Kansas City. But I'm not from there. I'm from New York, baby. I don't have no skin. Y'all need to be like that. You need to say, I'm like Peter. I cut off your ear and wait for a response later, baby. Peter had opposition against him. But guess what? Huh. Okay. God put his head back. You know, I mean, we have to be willing to be on the offense. And even when it don't look like it makes no sense. Because it was all them soldiers coming against Jesus. And Peter came and cut homeboy's ear. He wasn't scared of the result. You can't be scared. Even when it makes sense for you to be scared. But guess what? Look at him and say, I got God. I got God. I told Apostle Wright, y'all be seated, I apologize. Y'all be seated. I told Apostle Wright yesterday, I said, you know, everybody got to have a little Peter around now. A little Peter and a little John. Somebody's going to love on them, and somebody's going to war for them. I thank God I got all of that. And so, to answer. Point number three. Psalms 56 and 3 says, whenever I'm afraid, I will trust you. Point three says, "He, a good warrior is humble and gentle in victory. A good warrior. Say a good Christian soldier is humble in victory. What I'm saying is you have to be humble. Say humble. You don't have to worry about them. Your naysayers will be your motivators. So when I win, when they said I'll never succeed, we've been in this building 8 years. They've been naysaying all. They say, y'all can't afford that big building. I said, okay. I'll show you better. I can tell you. 8 years later, we ain't never miss a mortgage note. We ain't never miss a payment. We ain't never miss a bill. Why? Because God is with us. God can do a lot with a little, baby. He can make a victory cloud out of a drought. Only God can do that. So I said, okay, this big building, yeah, it's big. But it's getting paid for every payment, amen. And the bank is always blessed. We pay ahead of time. They like that. Look to your neighbor and say, neighbor, you stay humble. Humility is the key to your breakthrough. I want you to see this. Humility is your key to your breakthrough. It's easy when you win all the time to start to get proud. But stay low. When you stay low, God will take you high. Look, you want to go up in rank? Say, I want to go up in rank. I don't want to be a private, then private first class, and then Lance Corporal, then Corporal. I want to go up in rank quicker. The way you go up in rank quicker, stay humble. Let your neighbor say, stay humble. Say, stay humble. Say, Christian soldiers, stay humble. Stay humble. Say, I'm a good Christian soldier. I got one more point. I'll get ready to close. The reason why you have to stay humble in victory, because victory is guaranteed. I know it's not my last point, but I want y'all to write this down. Victory is guaranteed. I read the end of the book, baby. And when I read it, it tells me that the devil will be put away for 1,000 years. What I'm saying is, if you believe like I believe that we win, he loses. It's easy to stay humble when you already know the outcome. Y'all not talking to me here. It's easy to stay humble when you already know. I always tell them, when I'm playing spades and me and Brother Dale on teams, it's easy for us to stay humble, although we don't. It's easy for us to stay humble because we know we're going to win. It's easy for us to stay humble when we're playing dominoes. Why? Because we know we're going to win. They don't even like us to be on teams anymore because we win all the time. If we lose, it's only God checking us to keeping us humble. I don't take many. Yeah. I feel a down nose and a space coming on. So stay humble. Say, stay humble. Philippians 4:5 says, let your gentleness be known to all men. The reason why you can stay humble, because victory is guaranteed. Look to your neighbor and say, victory is guaranteed. Anybody want to sign up for that military? Well, you know when you go to war, I'm going to win. When you know I go to battle, I'm going to win. I might be going to Afghanistan or Iraq or Iran, but when I get there, I already know the outcome before I got there. I win. That's the army you want to sign up for, baby. That's God's army. When the enemy come against you, I win. When debt come on you, I win. Right, we got to get this. But when sickness and disease come on me, I win. When hurt, harm, and danger come on me, I win. When jealousy come on me, I win. When envy come on me, I win. When a lack comes on me, I win. When prosperity come on me, I win extra prosperity. Say, I win. And tell the devil he loses. And this the last one. This one, it really got me. My last point. Say, the good soldier's wishbone is not where his backbone should be. I feel I just got a little laser shot at me right there. It's time for us to stop a wishing and a hoping and get a little backbone and start talking. The reason why you're not succeeding because you're still hoping and a wishing instead of putting a backbone and holding on to your line. Hold the line, baby. I don't know what, it was the one with, it was Gladiator, what was the name of it? In the beginning of the movie, he said, hold the line, hold, as they was getting ready to go to war. Wishbone people where they ain't got no backbone, they getting off the line. But those that got a little backbone going to stay in line. They going to do what God called them to do. So when the enemy come against you, you got a little backbone. You got a little structure in you. You ready to fight. But if you got a wishing and a hoping bone, you need you'll run away. What I'm saying is a good soldier has a backbone. Look at him and say, has a backbone. Willing to fight. A good soldier's got some structure. A good soldier's willing to be in the battle. Not a scaredy cat. Somebody who's afraid to fight. You have a backbone. Look to your baby. You have some conviction, baby. So a good soldier got some conviction. I mean what I say, and I say what I mean. I'm not stuttering. I'm not speaking in tongues when I'm talking to you. I'm telling you what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes you got to tell, I have to go to my boys, am I speaking in tongues or am I speaking Swahili? What's going on? I mean what I say and I say what I mean. Yeah. You got to understand. Your word is your bond. Have some backbone. Look to them and say, have some backbone. Backbone is a strong bone, but when it's broken, it causes damage. A backbone is a very strong bone, but when it is broken, it causes severe damage. Don't let nobody break your backbone. That means don't let nobody break your word. Your word is your bond. Keep it. Look to them and say, I understand. I understand. Do I got some warriors in the house? If I got some warriors in the house, just stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. I'm going to say this, and it may offend some people, but I don't got to say it anyway. Jesus Christ got on the cross. He chose to get on the cross. That's some backbone. He could have canceled his own assignment. He was there at the beginning when God gave it to him. He was born into sin that we might live again. The precious Lamb of God. Lyrics. But he was born to die. I want y'all to get this in your spirit. He was born to die. John 3:16. He was born to die. His calling was to come to the earth and die, so that we might live. Our calling from our brother Jesus Christ, Spirit of God, is we should be born to die. We need to die to our flesh. We need to die to our self. Be willing to sacrifice. We should be born to die. Jesus did not get on that cross choose to stay there, be buried, rise again, so that when trouble come against you, you cut and run. Christians should not and are not made up that way. Good Christian soldiers do not cut and run. When the going get tough, the tough need to get going. I'm not talking about running away. I'm talking about digging deeper. Look to your neighbor and say, I'm digging deeper. We getting ready to do communion. And as the communion come forth, then we're going to have an altar call. But we're going to seal this. I got a whole bunch of warriors in this house. Do I got any warriors? If I got some warriors, make some noise. The Bible tells us that there are many times when there was a war cry. Do you have a war cry? Do you have a war cry? Your war cry should be, help me, Jesus. Your war cry should be, thank you, Jesus. My war cry should be, hallelujah. My war cry should be, amen, so be it. Say yes and amen. My war cry should be something that signifies your experience with God. We're getting ready to go to war, but there's going to be a war cry.